Will and Grace was one of those rare television programs with clever and very funny lines that were remembered and repeated in the days, the weeks and years after they were first aired on television. It was also the first American primetime sitcom to feature an openly gay feature character, and it's been credited with paving the way for future shows. But at its heart, it was funny, so incredibly funny. Jim Colucci is the author of Will and Grace Fabulously Uncensored, and he joins us now from Los Angeles.
Hey!
Hello! Jim, welcome to Studio 10. Thank you so much for joining us. Now, the show premiered a year after Ellen DeGeneres came out on her own TV sitcom, but that series didn't survive. Why do you think Will and Grace was such a success and found an audience while Ellen's didn't?
Will and Grace was smart enough, the producers and creators were smart enough that they learned from the Ellen show's mistakes. And whereas Ellen, the sitcom, really changed once her character came out, and of course that is a big life moment for a character, but I think that that confused audiences somewhat. Remember, this was the late 90s. People were much less familiar with gay and lesbian lead characters and people in their lives. So the Will and Grace producers knew to take it slow, and that was partly something they learned from Ellen. And so they knew that the audience might still have a rooting interest in Will and Grace almost in a romantic way, and maybe let's let them think that for the first season, and let's see Will and Grace give each other little kisses and show that they are soulmates even if they aren't physically romantic. Mm-hmm. And so I think it was a very smart move on the part of the Will and Grace producers that they took it slow.
Mm, it was incredibly smart and just incredibly funny. But it's been said the producers wanted it both ways, and they actually did look at the possibility of Will and Grace ending up together. I mean, what the...
Not the producers didn't really look at Will and Grace ending up together, but again, they didn't want to disabuse the audience of that idea if that's what that first season audience needed to think. I think that they really wanted the audience to fall in love with these characters as people, see how flawed and funny and quirky they are as people without the labels of sexuality on them. And then maybe later they could advance the storyline where Will could have a boyfriend and Grace could have a boyfriend and they wouldn't be together. But I think you're right, for that first season, they just wanted the audience to hold out that hope.
And now Eric McCormick, who played Will, isn't gay. So was that a really hard decision for him to accept the role?
It was a hard decision for Eric McCormick to decide to be Will, but not for the reasons I might have suspected before I researched this book. All through TV and all through film, there have been many actors who have feared playing gay roles, whether they were gay themselves and didn't want that to come out, or whether they didn't want to be pigeonholed as a gay actor and playing gay characters. None of that was really Eric's concern, to his credit. But I think that he felt, actually, that he didn't deserve to stand for a whole community of which he was not a part. And I also think that when you audition as an actor for an American TV show, you are signing a contract that says, if we select you, it's called a test deal, if we select you, you will play this role for 6 or 7 years. Wow. And so when you even go in to test for a character, you are committing 6 or 7 years of your life. Mm-hmm. And Eric was really reluctant to do that at first. He was a young actor with a lot of prospects, and this seemed scary to him. So originally he turned down the role of Will, and only a few months later did he wake up and say to his wife in bed, you know, have I made a terrible mistake? And she said, I think you have. Uh-huh. And so he went back to the producers, and luckily the role was still available.
So, Jim, considering you just said there that he originally turned down the role, did producers have anyone else in mind to play that character?
For all of the parts, all of the actors practically, Sean Hayes a little bit less because he had the confusion that he thought he was auditioning to be Will, actually. But for all the other actors, they had to be talked into those roles. And so for all of the roles, there were Plan B and Plan C and many other actors considered and auditioned. But the way that Will and Grace came about, NBC, the American network, had told the producers that Will and Grace was getting a pickup that was cast contingent, as they say, which meant that you have to find the right Will and the right Grace before we'll allow you to go any further. Eric McCormick said no, they had to go look at other people, but they were thrilled when he came back and said yes.
Once then they had their Will and Grace, how then did the other characters get their roles?
again, it's always a mix of these actors being known by the casting people. And so Sean Hayes was known somewhat by the casting person from Will and Grace. Again, I said I mistakenly promised that he'd auditioned to play Will. And same thing with Megan Mullally. She had actually auditioned to play Grace, hadn't gotten it, but the casting person knew of her. And when the Karen role was kind of rewritten a little because they were having trouble casting it, they thought of her and convinced her to play the role.
Wow, because it's impossible to imagine the show without them. I actually think the supports are funnier than the lead roles. Now, it features an incredible list of big-name guest stars. Madonna, Cher, Elton John, Matt Damon, whose cameo is the funniest thing he has ever done. How do they get such huge names on the show?
It was incredible. They really started out small by getting actors to whom they had personal connections. So the first big guest star that they were proud to get was Sidney Pollack, who played Will's father. And that was because one of the creators, David Cohan, had a personal connection to him. He was a famed director. And once the reputation of a show builds, it becomes the place that stars want to be seen. And it was known as a funny, smart show. And once you get one or two, the ball starts rolling. And if you look at the later seasons of the show, so many huge names stopped by.
And Elton John, he had a connection to one of the characters, or David Furnish did, I think.
Correct. Yeah. Yes. David Furnish was Elton John's partner, went to school with Eric McCormick in Canada.
Wow.
So, again, another personal connection that helped land one of the early big names.
What's the biggest catchphrase that came out of the show? I mean, I'm like, just Jack.
Yeah, just Jack.
Is that the biggest? Just Jack.
I would think it's the biggest, and the irony is, just Jack, the irony just is Jack, that Sean Hayes didn't like it. After a while, because too many people were stopping him in public and going like this. And so if you notice in later episodes of the show, they kind of steered away from Just Jack because it was getting to be too much. But
too
I
late.
Think that's a good sign when your show is such a cultural phenomenon that it's too late.
It certainly is. I just have to say, Matt Damon, who plays a straight guy who has to pretend to be gay so he can join the choir because all he wants to do is sing and dance, is just the best thing you've ever seen. And is it also true, Jim, that Joan Collins was almost cast in a semi-regular role?
Joan Collins did appear on the show once, and she was a very socialite and very wealthy decorator and a nemesis kind of Grace's and also of Karen's because as a socialite. And they wanted to have her back, and Joan had some restrictions of what she was willing to do with her character that didn't match what the writers wanted to do. And so they had to, at the 11th hour, reconceive that part. And luckily for us, Beverly Leslie was born.
Yes.
And so Leslie Jordan came in to play a part that was meant for Joan Collins, but that he went on to recur in and become an audience favorite.
Because was it Joan Collins didn't want her wig ripped off in the start? Was it something like that?
Yes, there were several things. She didn't want her wig ripped off. She didn't want to appear with a dog. There were a few other quirky things that she wasn't willing to play. And so she was replaced. And even though she's wonderful, she was replaced to our benefit because Beverly Leslie became a hit.
Mm. And Jim, we were saying earlier in the interview that this show certainly paved the way for sitcoms right across the world, but also for a lot of LGBTI rights in the US.
It did. The Will and Grace, in 1998, when it premiered, I don't think that anyone thought that in my generation, in my lifetime, we'd be seeing same-sex marriage in the U.S. or in Australia. Congratulations. And so I really think that the show helped bring gay and lesbian people into American living rooms. And people who didn't think they knew any gay and lesbian friends or relatives would suddenly, first of all, fall in love with the Will and Grace characters, but might also recognize parts of them in people in their own lives. And so I really think the show advanced gay and lesbian rights within the U.S. and really sped up that process to the point where in 2011 I married my husband, and
hey!
I never thought that was going to be possible.
Yay!
And, you know, if you look at... Thank you. If you look back in the days of the last presidential election before the Trump one, and Joe Biden was talking about, our then vice president, about how Will and Grace did more for advancing gay and lesbian rights and for rights in general than anything else in pop culture. Mm-hmm. And he specifically cited the show. And that's so powerful. When you have the vice president paying you compliments for your effect on America, that's pretty great.
Indeed. Now, Jim's fantastic book is called Will and Grace Fabulously Uncensored. There it is. And you can catch the original Will and Grace fantastic episodes on 11 and 10 Play. Jim, thanks so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you so much for having me.